thought was that Bill Gates guys, I mean, most of you might be using stuff, but things have changed with, yes. May I have your name?
And yeah, I'm
Lairo.
I'm working for Abona.
Abona.
Right. So, since we talked about service discovery, right, so I've seen some microservice architectures which doesn't use service discovery as a communication. Like using queues and things like Kafka kind of architecture. So, why people choose between service discovery and this kind of different mechanisms?
Alright, that's a good question. And I believe service discovery and what you mentioned, the messaging is two different things. The purpose is two different. So anyway, we have plans to talk some of the challenges when you have microservices. So to eliminate those challenges, we use the messaging. So so for example, if I think, so one of the most challenge, one of the serious challenges in microservices is that how are we going to manage the central decentralized data? So now each service has its own private DB. So the customer service will have MongoDB because and the order service will have MySQL because it's technically it's agnostic. So how am I going to maintain the consistency across these? And how am I going to take a view from both of these databases and then show it in a report? And for example, I need to query and get the customers and what are their order histories. So if in this case, if it's both in two different databases, then that's an issue. So that is fair. So in this case, we can't use like distributed transaction or two-phase commits. So that's why we go for a different approach. We go for event-driven approach. That's where the messaging comes. So maybe we can talk more onto this maybe later. So it's basically two different approaches. Yeah.
So basically, you want to have consistent view across your system, you want some sort of a more persistent type of queuing system to make sure you have consistency across all the microservices.
Yes, we achieve through eventual consistency.
We can discuss these things further when we come to challenges. Right? So,
yes.
Yeah, those are obvious issues we have. So I'll move on. So we are basically still we are on the grounds touching simple stuff. So I'd like to know this question is particularly for Asha. You built an application from the scratch. It is now deployed using microservices on serverless architecture. What are the do's and don'ts when you are initiating a product developer, and what actions that we should prevent, and what actions and where, when and where we should do certain things? That question goes to you.
Okay, so one of the main challenges when it comes to starting a new project with microservices, especially it's a greenfield project which you start from scratch, is selecting the platform. So you can pick different platforms based on maybe the regulations that you have, maybe going for cloud or going for in-house based stack, technology stack. So that's one of the challenges because you have to find something with at least some of your employees familiar. So that I found is one of the main challenges to find, because this is a new area and you want people who know about these at least one or two platforms. So that's one problem or challenge. And the other one is, let's say you pick a platform, then you have to understand the at least up to some depth how you are going to design the application in terms of microservices. Because it's quite common, since we are coming from a kind of a monolith application background, it's quite easy for us to design things wrong. In a more, you could say, ultimately it will become a monolith again. So it's quite important to design it in a way that you identify the business component and the necessary isolation. So this is another challenge. And Another thing is, since we are talking about technology agnostic these processes, as Arvind mentioned, choosing many technologies for different microservices is an option. So what is the limit? So that's again a challenging thing, because sometimes you can end up with using a technology. Let's say you write a reporting tool, reporting service with Java, and another service with Node.js, and maybe another with Python. So it's quite easy that your developers need to have more skills to keep them maintained. So these are kind of some challenges in decision making in the upfront development. And one important thing is, how do you set up your development now? Because today, if you think about the monolith, it's quite easy to set things up, because it's single binary that you can run in your local machine. But here we have to run multiple services. Maybe you have a limited network, you have limited ports, you have to set up your development environment in a way that it supports the necessary kind of having multiple services running in your local or at least in a different stage. So these are kind of things that you have to consider.
I guess Hashan covered all most of the challenges. So I would like to talk about the
migration.
Yes, the migration. So I have I broke monolith into a couple of microservices. So my strategy, or it can be varies, like depending on the all team. So my strategy, the strategy which we followed was we didn't start from scratch. So we started chunk by chunk. We start chunk by chunk. Like, let's say the example that I'm taking is the universal order manager. So we took the easiest one. What, let's say customer. So custom service, we took out the custom service. Then we developed that as a separate service. And then what we do was both this UOI, the order management, and the customer service was put into production. So that is one way. And then another strategy that you need to, when you see, okay, now my monolith is now is growing, it's very unmanageable. So then we need to stop adding new features into the monolith. So all those new features you can create. You can, if you say, okay, this is a, okay, this this is grouped around the business capability, a logical business capability, then we can go for microservice. And that, that is another way. And the third way is that we need, like, in a monolith, there are, let's say, the cross-cutting concerns. So, such as cross-security, logging, matrices, etc. So in monolith, we can think about once. But in microservice, each service, we need to think. So developers lose time by thinking those cross-cutting concerns. And we talk about now smart teams, so each team is working one microservice. So for that, you need to use frameworks like the Spring Boot, and they have some other like Drop Wizard, and they, for other language like Golang, they have GoKit. So these frameworks take care of those cross-cutting concerns. So what we can use those frameworks, utilize those frameworks, and create microservices faster, so that the developers, the team is focused mainly on the business functionality, so they can deliver fast. So that is what I perceive on tools and roles.
So Ashan touched on having a proper team part as well. So I was more of thinking of on the lead time. How long would it take to deliver something compared with monolith or normal application development, or if you opted to select opted to go for microservices. What is your opinion on that? If you are looking for faster delivery, is this a right decision to make?
That's a good question. If you consider about the fast delivery, I think it's better to go with what you know, not with microservices, if you are not familiar with it. So it's a straight answer. So, but there are some things like all of the start, the beginning is slow. Eventually, the advantage when using microservices, because maintenance becomes easy. So for fast, so things like that, you have to deliver in a couple of months, let's say 3 months, better go with what you are knowing and what you are using now. So that was the
answer. Guys, if you want to ask? Because we talked about, okay.
I'm Dolitha, I'm from WC. The question I had was like, I've been reading about microservices for about a year. So Martin Fowler, what he said is to do monolith first and then go to microservices, right? So you guys, like Ashan, you went from microservices first, right? And then you did the monolith and then the microservices, right? What type of things did you understand doing that instead of like you build a big gap and then you slowly transition to microservices? Because that's a lot easier, right? For example, if you use Node.js or something like that, you can easily build a monolith and then go to a microservice base. What do you guys think about that?
Alright, so I didn't mean create a monolith first and then come to the microservice. So each can have their own opinions. So what I meant first, so suppose we already have a monolith, and then how are we, if we are going for microservices, how we can break that monolith into microservices? So that is differs from what you mean. So it all depends on the situation. So if you are organization, if you are more into microservices, maybe it's less than Ashan said, even though it's slow, so once you get the comfortable zone, then okay, it's easier for to go directly into the microservices if you know okay, this particular new feature will deliver some business capability, some business like a unique feature that can be used by other services, and by collaborating we can get something bigger. So if you see that, then you can directly go for the microservice. And I don't prefer first writing the monolith and then going for microservice. So that will mean that means we are investing more time probably.
Give you my opinion on this. We started. If I talk about some of the brown people which was going on and how we migrate to microservices, it's my first since we already had a monolith. This is not about that. I talked just before, but experience on how we move the monolith to microservices, that again, first dockerizing the monolith, then we can use the same platform to keep it in running, and part by part, the new features or new, let's say, when we are doing something which is related to a certain area, business capability, we can just take that the chunk out as a new service. So that's how we move the migration phase. But when we started a new project, new greenfield project, then we were more focusing on the cloud, and I can answer that question in the coming area. We talk about the serverless infrastructure. Why we went with directly microservices rather than building the monolith first and going on. So I will answer that in the coming session.
Yeah. So I'm going to move to serverless. Anyone else having questions?
Yeah, my name is Brian, and I'm Brian Hogwartosa. Right. So my question is, when we come to microservices architecture, so it's an intermediate coming, right? So are there any performance concerns? Surely there should be, because everything happens with an endpoint, right? So compared to monolith service, one request might cater to multiple transactions, so whatever. Here you need to have several requests, or your gateway managers, your multiple requests at once. So again, the network latency comes into play. So are we introducing an additional overhead to our performance by doing for microservices?
It's a good question, because the latency is kind of concern. So we have different patterns on how you organize your microservices. So you can have some internal microservices versus some externally exposed microservices, where you can have aggregation microservices which aggregate certain things. For example, let's say you have mobile app. You don't want to invoke 5 microservices directly, because it can add to do a perform a single task, because it will definitely add latency. So have internal microservice which will consume a series of microservices inside and expose them directly. So the latency actually happens between the user and the end service. The internal it will work faster because they are close together. In terms of when using Docker and so on, it was quite better, but when using the serverless infrastructure, we had some problems. So that again, I will keep to the next point because there's a whole topic in terms of that. So,
On the same thing, do you guys use caching to do in between microservices? Do you cache objects?
Yes.
Like using KDOS sort of thing?
At the moment, we are not caching the in between things, but we use a cache for single service. But of course, we can, as the KDOS dependent suggests, we could use caching. And some of the Tekton platforms, they inherently support this. So, of course, it's optional.
There is a methodology of 12 attacks, so you might know that. So one of the methodology says that it talks about process. So that process is stateless process. Then it should not support any no sticky session, no like session affinities. Like it should do what it's supposed to do. No caching. So if you need to persist. You should use some backing service like database. So I see this principle can be applied for microservice as well. But you can go beyond that. You can even though you can't based on this you can't have caching because in the servers if you say you talk anyway in servers caching doesn't make sense. And get the optimization, get the performance, you can have maybe memory caching, that's okay.
The question is not exactly on the server side, but from the client side you can cache. So
client caching is up to the client, they can have any.
But now, imagine a scenario where you have multiple microservices running in the same container, not same container, multiple containers, and there's an aggregator going through. That aggregator can do caching, right? To increase the performance.
So in terms of that, the aggregate itself becomes a single endpoint, a single service. So of course we can do caching there. So it's, then the knowledge that it has, the external system has on the service is just a single endpoint. So of course there you can have, but what's the difficult, what's not possibility or at least not recommended is to cache, let's say having a single cache for different things. So it's then again dependent on each other.
This caching just solves issues up to a certain extent, right? Doesn't solve all your issues. Can you give some numbers on your experience on AWS? How you overcome these issues?
Okay, so since we mentioned about the AWS and the platform, so I will just give you a little bit of introduction about servers as well, what you're talking about. So when developing microservices in the cloud, for example, let's say AWS, Amazon Web Services, there are managed services which will provide computation, gateways, data storage, and so on, where these can independently scale and also independently provision. So when we build a microservice fleet with these cloud native services, then that's what we call in a single word called servers. It's not a server, it's just servers, it's just a bus name, password. So when using servers, so there are some popular pros and cons of
mostly, but we, I think because it's better, you can go for microservices.
Just to add to his answer, also answer the question. It's a very again difficult question to answer because you never know how you how you initially divide the application will go right as individual microservices. So it's a kind of you start with your logical approach of dividing things with business capabilities, and then gradually separate things up. For example, if you find something that is not meaningful in putting in this service, you later can decide on moving it to the other. Because it's not there's no hard and fast rule how you can find business boundaries or boundaries of these microservices. So it's not a one-time approach. The dividing, it's just from my experience, you start with it and then you identify how you again go forward with the isolations and so on. So.
From my experience, there are no hard and fast rules on how you would kind of break the pieces into microservices, but you would closely follow domain-driven architecture in terms of that, and the application would be designed in a way that it's self-contained and it can be deployed in the Lambda or a user. So my point is, as best as you can is in the application, not only in modules, but in the separate components itself. I think that's the rough guideline plan.
Yes.
You have separate databases, one MongoDB, one Cassandra, Couchbase. So how do you keep references between foreign keys, or how do you normalize the application? What's the best practice?
You highlighted domain-driven design.
Well, basically, what in microservices architecture, you have smart endpoints in some parts. So, what you would have to do is you would have to encapsulate all the logic that would be handling the referential integrity into that endpoint. So you can't send primary keys and stuff like that over the wire.
Rerouting. You guys have anything there?
Yes. So that is one of the main. So that is even first. So as I said. So there are one way that, anyway, we summarized this before, that event-driven is the approach. So we use event-driven and we achieve the atomicity through that. So without using a transaction, like a distributed, in this case, what makes sense for the distributed transaction, but database should be private for that service. So there is no go for the distributed transaction. So I see there are many ways that we can achieve. So one, let's take example. Let's say you have one service. Anything. Okay. Anyway. Let's. Okay. That's one thing we can use. We can have a table. Let's say order table, and then we can have another table called events. So when the order is created. So then we can insert an event, another record in the event table, okay, with a local transaction. So we are sure the atomicity is there. So that event table can act as a message queue for, or maybe a message broker. So we publish an event. So whoever subscribe, maybe let's say some customer or maybe some warehouse. So when they get it, okay, they know their order is now the order is now persisted. So then they will proceed further from that. So that is one way to achieve the atomicity using the event driven, and there are many other ways as well.
You have to give up relational thinking?
Just to add something that you have answered, like, just to repeat the same answer, just that the audience can understand it clearly. So when you think about microservices, the service layer itself is not technical microservices,